Happy Sabbath, everyone. Oh, let's do it one more time. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Nice. It's nice to see all the smiley faces with the beautiful hearts and sweetheart and with the willing to worship God. Let's start off by our Sabbath service with the song 672, Spirit of the Living God.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me.
Good morning and welcome, and I want to welcome each one of you here this Remembrance Day as we remember what God has done in our lives. John 15:13 says, "Greater love hath no man than this." What is it? That a man lay down his life for his friends. We remember on Remembrance Day, today, November 11th, at 11 a.m., the First World War, when the ceasefire was made. And we come together today as a nation to honor the bravery of our men and women in uniform, those who have and are currently serving boldly and bravely. And we thank you for your service. I want to ask this morning, how many have served in a position protecting us? And I'm going to be very vague here. What I see protecting us is could be you could have served as a prison guard. You could serve in the police, a border crossing, the military. Anyone here in that position who has done that, put your hand up. Okay, the next, how many of family that has served or is serving in these positions? Like I said, it could be a prison guard who protects us, police, border crossing, military, anyone who has family or relatives serving like that. Look around you, there's quite a few hands raised in the air. Even Vera and I's son served in the Navy for 16 years. Again, I say thank you for your service. Today, I also want you to think about Christian service and what that means. Specifically, our missionaries who serve in difficult places and situations. Hundreds have lost their lives due to conflict, starvation, and disease while serving others. Today, I want us to pause and hear in the quiet, pray for the living survivors who must carry on alone. Pray for the safety of those who are continuing to serve, whether in a service of military or missionary. At this time, we're going to take a moment of silence, and I want you all to offer prayers for those who are serving, have served, who have survived. And then afterwards, we'll stand and sing our national anthem. We find in the book of Genesis, the very first book of the Bible, the very first chapter, the character of God repeated numerously. And what does it say? It says, God is good. And you say? All the time, God is good. Isn't that wonderful? When we open the Bible, doesn't matter where it is, when we read into it. Because in Genesis, it says, God saw everything he made and it was good. And you can't make good stuff with a bad character. And this is the character of God. God is good, and I'm grateful for that. Well, good morning and welcome to everyone here on this rainy Remembrance Day. And for those of you viewing us online, welcome also. Today is truly a day of blessing. Our announcements are first, where is Natalia and Sasha Danilitz? I see them here. Oh, there they are. Put your hands up higher. Nobody can see you. This is our first reading. We've been for a year now trying to get their membership transferred from the Ukraine. And you know what's going on there. It's been very difficult because it's all been in paper, no computer stuff. And we finally got from your church. We didn't get Alicia yet, but we got the parents. And so this is our first reading, but you've been here like a year, but welcome anyways. Also, the second reading, we greatly miss Christina and Carolee Nagy, who are going to support their daughter in Maple Ridge. And this is something we vote on, and with some sad hearts, because they're great people. But do we have a motion for their transfer to Maple Ridge? Yes. All in favor, put your hand up. Okay, thank you. Today is the first in a series of meetings with Pastor Tony Cortez. He is speaking here today at 11, and according to our schedule, it also says that he is going to speak tonight at 5 p.m., and then we have next Friday at 5 p.m., Saturday during the worship service, and then after potluck. So I hope you all can come out for that. Tonight also, the Adventurers are doing a fundraising tonight in the gym at 5:30. They're going to sell snacks to raise funds and have a movie for you. So come on out and support them. And next week, we expect a larger turnout. We're asking that to bring some extra food for potluck.
Thanks, JD. I just had one more announcement that didn't make the bulletin. We've decided to have a musical church service in December, so I will be personally stalking you if you don't come to me and volunteer first. So all of you with hidden instruments under your bed or songs that you would like to sing, we'd like to get a whole service of musical pieces together. It's December 16, so please come and see me before I see you.
You heard that. Becky's going to stalk you if you don't join up. Wonder what that looks like. Anyway, sounds like fun time. So December 17th, musical service for the season. Okay, look in your bulletin. I did not cover all the announcements, okay? So keep that all in mind. But again, welcome this morning. We're glad you're here to worship with us.
And good morning, church.
Morning.
Happy Sabbath. Lord's good all the time. So we're going to have what's called a health nugget, and we're just going to focus on a few things that that we talk about in the health world as Adventists. But before I do that, I just want to remind you that next Sunday at 4 o'clock, we're going to be having a cooking class. It's going to be pretty simple, just like sandwich type fillings, like scrambled tofu and an egg salad, you know, all plant-based, of course, so that if you have to, you know, put together a lunch or something for the holidays, you can, you know, how to do it really well. plant-based. We're just going to have a cooking class. I have more of these in the back, just on the table on the outside. You can pick one up, invite a friend. So it's 4 o'clock next week, Sunday. So that's what we wanted to talk about. Okay, so, oh, by the way, I just want to mention a little FYI. Just in the mother's room there, the window just blew out, and there's glass all over. So I picked up all the heavy stuff. Rick and I cleaned it up, and I think he's duct taping the window there. So just be careful if you have to go in the mother's room. A lot of the toys had glass inside some of the boxes, so that has to be completely cleaned up. So I just want to point that out. We need to clear that up before we go in. Okay, so I'd like to share a little bit with you, maybe about 5-10 minutes, my health nugget for today. And it's, let's see if I can get it to go here. Perfect. All right, so we're going to talk about temperance. So if I were to go around the room and ask what is temperance, I'd probably get about 40 different answers. Most people, what they would say about temperance is that it's just using a little bit of something, not overdoing things, just being moderate. And so the question I'd like to ask at that point then is, how much would you say is a moderate amount of cyanide? Oh, okay, so really then, the true temperance then isn't just using a little bit of anything and being careful with it. We need to be very diligent, because true temperance is really this. Temperance is avoiding all that is harmful and using wisely the things that are good. So even the things that are good for us, we still need to use wisdom when we make a decision on using it. And so that's important to understand. So let's move on. So some of the things are pretty obvious, right? Most people, yeah, I definitely want to stay away from refined foods. I definitely want to stay away from stuff like, not to pick on any particular place, but so McDonald's fries has about 19 ingredients. So the first three I understand. Fry, like potato, salt, and oil. But where are the 16 ingredients coming from? Okay, so there you go. Is that something that we want to be consuming? You know, is it healthy for us? Is it something that we should maybe avoid versus using a little bit at all? So we want to make good decisions with our foods. We want to stay away from refined foods. A lot of things that we want to stay away from as we think about temperance. Again, these are some obvious ones that people will know about: alcohol, tobacco, stuff like that. We definitely want to make sure that, because remember, our bodies are the temples of God, and we have to take care of it accordingly. Of course, again, most people will say, yeah, for sure, I stay away from drugs, and it's not a part of what I get involved with, and so forth. But we want to make sure we avoid it. And, you know, nothing against prescription drugs, but do you know that 100,000 people die each year from medications that are rightly taken, rightly prescribed from doctors? 100,000 people die from medication that's prescribed from their doctor, and they're following the program, but they die from it. So that's a whole different conversation. But I want to dig into a little bit more as to why do we have a health message? Why do we have temperance? Is it important? Some people don't really think much about it. They go, well, I just go to church, read my Bible, that's all I need to worry about. But let's take a look at this. I'm not sure if you guys can read this, but I'll read it for you. So temperance and salvation, does it have anything to do with my salvation? Doesn't really matter, who cares, right? I'm saved by Jesus, and absolutely true, you're saved only by Jesus. But it says temperance and salvation. As a people, we have been given the work of making known the principles of health reform. There are some who think that the question of diet is not sufficient importance to be included in their evangelistic work, but such make a great mistake. God's word declares, whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Amen?
Amen.
The subject of temperance in all its bearings has an important place in the work of salvation. Okay, and let's dig in some more as to why that is. Eternal interest. The hazards of turning from light. Whoever turns from the light in one instance hardens his heart to disregard the light upon other matters. Whoever violates moral obligations in the matter of eating and dressing prepares the way to violate the claims of God in regards to eternal interest. Are you guys starting to see the connection here? Okay, I'll read this one. Why the temperance message is vital. The Christian will be temperate in all things. Amen? In eating and drinking and dressing, in every phase of life, every man that strives for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. We have no right to indulge in anything that would result in a condition of mind, condition of mind that hinders the Spirit of God from impressing us with the sense of our duty. It is a masterpiece of satanic skill to place men where they can with difficulty be reached with the gospel. Are you guys understanding what's happening here? That the lifestyle that we live can prevent our minds from being clear enough to understand spiritual things. Are you guys seeing how this is connecting? Okay. Oh, I got one more. Okay, it's fine. So the point of this is, it's so important to understand that temperance is not something that we just go, oh, we talk about it. Back in the 1800s, they had temperance societies, and it was very common to abstain from alcohol and tobacco and stuff like that. But the health message was given to us for several reasons. But it was given to us so that not only is God's people, when the movement, our movement was starting, that we could be people with clearer minds and have a better connection with God. It's so that we had an opportunity to help others. Because everyone, basically illness is a common thing in the world of sin, but everyone has something to deal with. And we call it today the right hand of the gospel. It's an entering wedge to have a conversation with someone about their cold, their flu, whatever situation they have, we have something to share with them. And as you help them, Christ's method alone, you can then bid them, follow me. Or they'll say, hey, why did you help me? And how can I learn more about this healthy stuff that you're doing? So the health message has so many things packed into it. Not only does it draw us closer to God in a sense, remember, it's called health reform for a reason. The reform part is sometimes we forget. What are we reforming back to? God's original plan for man. Does that make sense? So I'll be sharing again later this evening and tomorrow and next week. We'll have some more health nuggets. But for right now, I just want to set a stage to let you know the health message is really a gift from God to be used for His glory and also to help us to feel better and to live better, healthy lives. Okay? God bless you.
Let's go back to our worship and welcome the President Candice, our BC Conference President. Welcome to Chilliwack SDA Church. We are happy to have you here. So as we remember, today is the Remembrance Day. We remember all of our heroes who fought for our countries from different places, different nations during the World War I and II, and even now we see in the news the war is happening in Ukraine and Israel. So we're questioning why these soldiers just left their houses, left their family, wife and children, go fought for their country, against other countries. One thing that for sure that because they have their love. They have the love to sacrifice and the love that asks the reasons, the love that stands the test, and the love that never falters, the love that pays the price. Let's sing, I Vow to Thee, My Country.
Thank you.
soldiers of different countries going for war with a gun, with ammunition, the army of the kingdom of heaven going for war with cross of Christ. Let's sing. Onward, Christian soldier. Soldiers going forward, because we recognize that the biggest sacrifice of our hero is in Jesus, and we realize that how amazing is our God sacrificed his only son just to save our world. Amazing grace.
Bye.
joyful, joyful, we adore thee, and but finally we enter. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. And let's stand.
Also thank you for this body of believers that serve you and commit their life and their money, their time, the resources. Thank you for that. I thank you for those that serve in positions of trust that protect us. I ask you to bless those people and keep them safe, Lord. And this Sabbath day, Lord, speak to us. Speak to us through Pastor Tony. May we all be blessed because we were here. We have listened. We have heard. We just want to give thanks now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church. I just want to share a little bit something with you. Today is my big, big anniversary. 32 years ago, on November 11th, in 1991, for the very first time, I entered in Seventh-day Adventist Church in New Westminster. So a few months after that, I was baptized. I was ready to be baptized that day that I was walking in the church. And so this day, it's always, always, not just as remembering day of what the many people give lives for us to be living in a, such a peaceful world, I mean, country here, the other world is a different thing. But it's also very special for me. And God did so many, so many wonderful things in my life and so many blessings.
What would you sacrifice? Deuteronomy 16:17. Every man shall give as he is able, according to the blessing of the Lord your God, which he has given you. If you could save someone's life by risking yours, would you do it? If this person were a stranger, would you risk your life to save them? If you could make a difference in someone's life by giving up something you enjoy for one day or one week, would you do it? What would you give up? A favorite meal, a new pair of shoes, a day's income? Think about what you can give up this week so someone you don't know can be introduced to Jesus. What are talking about special or sacrificial offerings who's given by being prompted by the Holy Spirit and in addition to it or being beyond our regular and systematic offering called promise. If your gift is small, maybe $10, it might buy 5 Bibles or outreach books that tell someone about Jesus in their own language. If you give $25, your offering could help sponsor a seminar about healthful living. And if you feel you should give a day's income, your offering could sponsor a global mission pioneer in a city where most people have never heard about Jesus. Whatever you give, your sacrificial offering will be used to tell others about Jesus. And just think, your sacrificial offering could make it possible to meet the person you sacrificed for in heaven. You can determine what you will sacrifice or ask God what he wants you to sacrifice for him. This week, beyond your regular tithe and offering, ask God and then listen to his answer. Be confident that God will provide your needs because you trust him. We sacrifice so that someone somewhere will meet Jesus. A homeless family won't have to beg for their next meal, or maybe a wealthy family can learn that all their wealth means nothing without Jesus. Would you sacrifice for them? How much is the soul of any person worth? To Jesus, any soul is worth everything, for he died for them. And you. Perhaps you are not prepared to give your sacrificial offering today or wish you had sacrificed more. You can give your sacrificial offering at any time. Just write annual sacrifice on your electronic or regular offering envelope and turn it in before God's generated conviction may subside. In Hebrews 13:16, Paul says that sacrifices are pleasing to God. So let us ask the Lord to bless our offerings of sacrifice so that they multiply and help global mission pioneers reach the outreach.
Okay, because our deacons and deaconesses stand to take up the offering and to say a prayer. Dear God, we thank you for the Pathfinders here that represent service. And we thank you for everyone and their service. And we pray this in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
apologize, I missed the announcements because I have the joy of going and picking up my dad at a long-term care facility in between Sabbath school and church. So sometimes it's a little bit longer of a get out. And today the entire ward was just mystified because walking down the street was a black bear. So anyway, so I missed this announcement. So I just ask for your patience with me. Many of you have been called already because we know that this is the time of year where we have the joy of coming together as a nominating committee to fill the positions that are God-given and also to serve him more effectively. So we are still missing a few positions. So I just ask that you will prayerfully consider and search your heart to see if maybe the Holy Spirit is urging you to serve the Lord in a position with the church. We're still looking for a Sabbath school superintendent, and having just coming to the close of a 2-year term doing that, I can assure the next person that's willing to take that on, it is very rewarding. It's extremely challenging, but it also, it's the beginning of our Sabbath worship every Sabbath, and we will always have enough to study in searching the Word. So if any one of you is considering that, please get in touch with me or the pastor. And then additionally, we have some tireless women that are working very hard in the kitchen for our potlucks. And I just wanted to let you know that we are looking to do a special end-of-year potluck. And we've had great success in the past when we do a theme. So if anyone has a suggestion, some ideas we were toying with are doing like a breakfast-themed end-of-year potluck where we did pancakes and we had all sorts of different toppings and maybe did like a tofu scramble and some potatoes or something. But we just find that it's a little bit more meaningful, and that's the whole point, right, is this opportunity to fellowship, which we know is based on koinonia. It's that beautiful spirit-led time where we come together to enjoy each other's company but to glorify God. So I just invite anyone who has an idea to please get in touch with us, and I just wanted to also remind you that there's still an opportunity to serve in a term for the next couple years in a position with the church. So I thank you so much, and I get to introduce that we're going to do the children's story next. So we have all the beautiful little people want to come up and listen to a story. Thank you.
And I want to invite the Pathfinders. I want the Pathfinders up here with their uniforms. Don't they look good today? Yeah. Okay, Pathfinders, come on up. It's good to see you all here. Aren't you all nice and smiley? Oh, and you're very pretty looking for the girls and handsome for the boys. You bet. Well, if you heard before the offering, the little reading talked about missionaries. How many of you know what a missionary is? Anyone? You know what a, there's two hands. Do you know what a missionary is? Anyone else know what a, here's one over here. Three? Okay. Give them a smiley face. Give them a smiley face because they know what a missionary is. Okay. When we say someone who serves, like in the police or the military or something, do you know what we're talking about? Someone who serves. You understand that phrase, serve? Yes? Well, in our church, this might be a little deep, but why do you come to church every Sabbath? Play with your friends? Yes, of course. To have fun? Yes, of course. To learn about Jesus? Yes, of course. What else? It's also training, so you learn to serve. So where's our Pathfinders at? Okay, right here we have two. Great. Look at them in their uniforms. Don't they look nice?
I tried this morning, okay?
What happens in Pathfinders? One of the key things of Pathfinders is to learn to serve. And what serve mean? It means volunteer. It means help mom with the dishes, sweep the floor, make the bed, put away your toys, all the fun stuff. Is that fun?
Yeah.
I know. And we learn to serve. Let me tell you a story about the very first missionary, 150 years ago. Can you believe that? Well, Mr. Andrews was asked to be a missionary to Europe, the very first one from North America. And he went. He didn't say, let me think about it. No, he went. And he went to Europe. And they had a big task for him. It was very daunting for him to do. And he worked and he worked. And you know what? He had no money. We have today 1,500 missionaries that go with no money. They support themselves in 160 countries. 1,500 missionaries. How many? Do we have that many here?
One, two.
I need to borrow your fingers if I'm going to count. Put your fingers up. Let's see. 1,500. And the missionaries serve. And Mr. Andrews went and served in Europe with no money. And do you know what he lived on? What did he eat? White bread, potatoes, and sometimes cabbage. Oh man, that's not a very good health message, is it? But he got sick. He got sick. He only served there 7 years. He got so sick he died. That's sad, isn't it? But in this, when he died, he said, don't have a funeral, don't write anything in the papers, because I am just a servant of God. I am not important. But he left behind a legacy. What's a legacy? Something we remember. It's when we do good stuff. We remember legacies. And so now we have a big university called Andrews University to remember him. Today I see you wearing a nice poppy. We do this to remember those who serve. You know, when we look at our Pathfinders, we think of service, of doing good things, helping mom and dad, closing the door, shutting the window when it rains, putting our seatbelts on by ourselves, right? Those are the little things we do to serve. Does anyone help your mom and dad? Put your hand up. Yeah, I see one hand. Mm-hmm. Oh, do you help your mom and dad? Yes? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I
tried
to.
They all deserve one. Start peeling them off. Okay. There's a big one for you. I'll get your hair in there. Oh, this one matches your red. That isn't pretty. Okay, put it over there, Vera. And that's what we're today. Today we're talking about service, helping people. And even though you're small, you can help, can't you? Okay. Who would like to say a prayer this morning and thank God for people who serve, such as missionaries and the military, and pray that God would be with them? We volunteer? Anybody want to say a prayer? Okay, let me pray. Dear God, thank you that we can serve you and serve others and be helpful and kind and have two ears so we can listen. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, grab a basket. Our offering we take up according to our church treasurer goes to the Pathfinders. So let's take a basket and we pick up spare change and $50 bills. Thank you.
voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure. Sum of every high and every low. Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. You say
I'm going to read a verse now. Okay. Was it John? Luke. Luke 19:10. The Son of Man came to find lost people and save them. Amen to that.
Good morning. And I can concur to that. Amen to that. Thank you for the reading. Thank you for having us here at your church. I think you've been so kind to us. You might look at me and say, why is he wearing that? Didn't he know he was speaking at church? And honestly, I feel a little bit uncomfortable, but I was running a camp this morning and we were under the rain. I have boots because we are basically working. And as soon as we finish here, we're heading out to the streets. That's why they are tired. But if you come next Sabbath, you might get to see a suit and a tie. So bear with me and be patient because we're getting there. Now I have a special support this morning with us and for us also with the youth. Pastor Brath, thank you for being here with us today. He has some words to share as well.
Good morning, church. I'm so happy to have the privilege of being here this morning, and particularly with Pastor Tony. We're here to affirm, I'm here to affirm in a very strong way the youth ministry for the British Columbia Conference, but particularly for this Chilliwack Church. I've heard the reports of how our church school has grown this year. Praise the Lord for that. That's Amen. Just fantastic. And the Pathfinders, to have them leading out like this in the service. And now for you as a congregation to sponsor the meal and to have everybody here, I can only say thank you, thank you, thank you. On our British Columbia Conference, our youth ministry is a very, very, very important component of everything that we're doing. And I am very, very glad for Pastor Tony to accept this responsibility and to make a phenomenal start at getting this whole project going, expanding and developing and building on what the foundation that we've already had. So thank you, church, for what you're doing. Last night, Candace and myself were up at Camp Hope. They had a communion service. I wish you could have been there. It was deeply, deeply spiritual. It was just something that where the speaker went through the events of the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, it was moving to my heart. And to have the young people wholeheartedly join in, it was wonderful. So I just want to thank you, Pastor Tony, for your leadership. And, you know, today on this day, it's a remembrance day. I apologize that I don't have a poppy on my lapel. When Pastor Tony said he was going out on the streets, I said, I got to be prepared to go out on the streets too. So I put my jeans on this morning, and that's why I'm dressed the way I am, because we're going out together here in a few minutes' time. So thank you, church, and may we continue to attract young people and build everything we can in our church school, our Pathfinders, our youth programs, and let us be people of prayer and the practicality of welcoming people, young people with maybe the backgrounds where they don't have everything understood as much as they do for us as older people, but we need to open the doors of the church wide and help people to come in and to grow and develop. Thank you, Tony, for what you're doing.
Thank you, Pastor.
Excuse me, I'm not trying to, walk out on your sermon, brother, but I'm going next door.
Oh, cool. For those of you who haven't noticed, we have about 200 and something people on that gym. There's no room for anybody else. It's packed. We brought 6 buses full. In fact, we had 5 buses, and then we had people that couldn't fit, and we said, well, we had the last resort, the last bus that we thought we weren't going to use, and we said, buckle up, because we need it. So we have 6 buses ready, and today, around 2 o'clock, we're heading to downtown Chilliwack. We're going to be doing some plays out in the street. We're going to be playing music. And we had over 250 sandwiches being prepared with juice boxes to share with the people out there. So if you would like to come and be part of this outreach, please join us. This is the city that God has chosen. And I think Chilliwack needs help. We went out with Pastor Okumu a few weeks ago to the city hall and to the police station. And we wanted to know if there was any concerns or did we need any permit to do this activity. The words from the city hall and the police department said, please and thank you for coming to our city. Welcome to our city. We need you guys here. I said, I'm bringing you 200 people. Would you mind? They said, no, by all means, come. Come and support. So we are joining effort with the Church of Chilliwack. We're partnering together. And this is how youth ministry can grow. We're not separated from the church. We're not a different movement. We are the same movement. We just work in different ages. Some groups are working with pathfinders. Some groups are working with youth. Some groups are working with adults. But we all are reaching the same goal. We all are facing the same goal. And that's exactly why we need to come together in support. And thank you. Thank you for providing the meal. I know it's not... First of all, there are people here that don't know the backstory, but we started with like 90 people, and I said, can you feed 90? And then we said, can you feed 120? And recently I got an email, can you tell us exactly how many? I said, well, honestly, every day the number keeps going up. I can't really tell you, but be prepared for about 200. So we're hoping that the beans have enough water. If not, we'll throw some more. But God is good with us, and I think this is leaders in the making. What I've been sharing with the youth is you are the generation that is going to move the church to the next level. I need you to see that it's not just about getting entertainment. It's about coming to meet with Jesus and then going out. Coming, receiving, and then we go out. Same thing we're doing here this morning. So let's have a word of prayer as we speak, as we start. Father in heaven, we came to this place to listen to you. I mean, throughout the week, we've been so busy. We've been hearing many things, even visually. We've been so distracted, Lord. But now we ask you to humbly help us to listen to your voice. We want to listen to your advice. We want to hear who you are. We want to understand Jesus in a deeper way. May you talk to us, especially each one of us that are here. May you talk to us directly, Lord. We humbly ask you to please send your Holy Spirit to this place and allow us to hear you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to talk to the pathfinders who are here tonight, today, and the youth. But this is going to cover everybody, I hope. It's interesting how Jesus chose specific individuals to change the outcome of history. When you look into the history of our church, it all started with young people. And when you look into the history of the disciples, they were young people too. Seems that Peter was one of the oldest ones, but he was probably in his 20s. I mean, John was probably 14, 15, and we don't know exactly their age, but they were young. Now, I want you to come to your Bible, please, to John chapter 6, because that's where we're going to find the story we're talking about today. And this is crucial because Jesus is going to do something that is going to change the history of how we tell the Gospels, how we hear the stories, and it's based on a very small or young individual. Now, I want to give you also some facts, some data that you need to understand and see why we're having such a hard time getting also the youth involved at times. Have you noticed that's a hard thing to do? Have you noticed that at times we would like to have the church full with youth and young people, but they're not necessarily here? Well, one of the things is that right now, just so you know, young people, the Generation Z said, it seems that they're spending about 4 minutes outside their homes in an average. How much? Per day. How many minutes? 4 minutes. Like, you come from a generation that you used to be brought in by your mother or father saying, come back home, we need to go to sleep, you need to shower, you need to do your chores. And what would you say to that? Oh, can I stay a little longer? Can I stay outside? Mom, can I go out? Wasn't that something you used to hear back in the day? Or you used to say? Being at home was the most boring thing ever. It was something that you didn't want to be, you didn't want to do, because you knew that everybody was playing outside and you just wanted to go out on the street and play with your friends. In today's time, we're just having a hard time saying, can you go out? Get out of the house? Leave? Just go see some sunshine, you know, get some air, some fresh air? Well, this is the struggle that we're facing in today's time, guys. And the struggle is real because parents are seeing it. Every time a child stays indoors, what's the next thing he's going to have in his hands? Oh, that's right. You see it too. You understand that too. they are on their tablets or on their cell phones. Well, this is a challenge situation we are facing in today's time. Having kids getting involved in Pathfinders, having children getting involved in club ministries, sending them to Hope and Mountain View Summer Camp makes a complete difference in their year. Not just in that week, their whole year changes just because they are experiencing nature in a way that they would not if they weren't to be sent out. This is the reality we're living on. Now, this generation, the generation that is covering between 10 years old and 16 years old, 17 years old, they have some very specific things that they claim about themselves. Number one is that there is not a specific truth, meaning that knowing God in this church is almost the same thing as knowing God in any other church. Every church presents God, and they're okay with that. 60% of them, how much? 60% of them believe that telling the truth is not necessarily important. So they can come to you, and I'm not saying they all are, but they can come to you and tell you in your face a lie, and it's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Have you encountered that at home? Have you experienced that on the streets? Have you experienced that interacting with younger people? And you feel like, well, you just said something that you weren't supposed to. Why? It's normal. It's what everybody does. This generation is the generation that is looking to see if what we say makes sense with what we do. What did I just say? If what we say makes sense with what we do. They want to see that if we claim to be Christians and loving and kind and compassionate, are we doing it as well? Now, Jesus is going to deal with his disciples in certain ways that is just interesting, you know. He's working with the multitudes, but he's also working with his disciples because he needs to teach them and he needs to train them. And this is exactly what he's doing. And I have a theme or a phrase that I'm developing with the leaders right now that I'm working with. These are the young people. And I said, you guys are leaders in the making. You guys are going to be the next generation leaders. And just giving you a heads up, what we're planning to do, we are planning to divide, and we are dividing the BC Conference in five different regions. Five different regions, the whole BC Conference is going to be divided. And each region is going to have their youth advisories. There is going to be teams of groups working in each region to care, to provide, to disciple, to nurture each of the youth that are living within that region. Right now, the problem we're having is that we're sending kids to Camp Hope, to Mountain View, and they go to the youth retreat, and they get excited, they get connected, but then they come back, and they come back to what? Nothing is happening. Their region is not necessarily working, so we are changing that. And last night I challenged them and I said, out of you guys, I will have the next leaders who are going to be running the conference. So I want you to pray for that. I want you to pray that they when they hear the calling, they will accept that challenge. This is the time that they need to take on. Now Jesus is about to tell us one of the biggest stories, the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verse 1. It says that after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and the great multitude followed him because they saw his signs that he was performing. Now, in other Gospel, Jesus says that when Jesus saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion because he saw them as people who had no one to care for them, as sheep without a shepherd. When you read this whole narrative, this whole story in the book of Matthew, you will learn that early that day, Jesus had received the news that his cousin had been decapitated. Jesus is dealing with a lot. In fact, previously, he had gone to his home. He had gone to his home crowd, his area where he grew up, and he went and he wanted to do many signs among them. He wanted to heal them. He wanted to perform. He wanted to preach. He wanted to reach out to them. But the multitudes were basically against that, and they end up kicking him out of his town. The Bible says that they were offended by his presence there. Offended, that's a big word. They were offended by his presence in Nazareth and the area where he was born, where he used to be as growing up. Now Jesus had left that region, and later on he receives a phone call, he receives a memo, he receives a text message saying, your cousin, the one you love, is dead now. Can you see Jesus dealing with this pain? The Bible says that he went away. He wanted to go on his own. He wanted to go to a separate place to pray. And this is important for us to know. When we go through troubled times, when we go through moments of struggle, we must learn to take the time to pray, to recover. Come to God. He has the answer for you. Now we go into this area now where Jesus is now seeing the multitudes. He's starting a day earlier. The multitudes understood that Jesus had gone around this area of the Sea of Galilee. And as soon as they heard that he was there, man, they booked it to that place. They started running. They wanted to go and see where Jesus was. It was very hard for him to find some space or some quiet time for him or for his disciples. When they heard that he was moving and he was mobile, he was going to this area, the multitudes just went up and followed him. We get to chapter 6 of John, and now Jesus is seeing this multitude. And as he's seeing the multitude does not understand that Jesus just lost one of his friends, one of his cousins, his beloved cousin. They don't understand the day that he's been going through, a rough moment, talking about mental health, the stress that he's going through. They all understand is that they need something from Jesus, and they're coming to get it. And Jesus sees them. And the Bible says that when he saw them, he was moved with compassion. Please think about this Jesus that is moved with compassion because he sees you. He sees me. He understands what I'm going through, and he's moved with compassion when we come on to him. Now we get to chapter 6 of John, and now we understand that Jesus is seeing the multitude, and he's working with his disciples. And the multitude is getting hungry. You know, the multitude is not a fun place to be. The multitude is not caring necessarily for your feelings. When the multitude gets hungry, they start rumbling. You know, they start talking just like any other multitude. When things are not looking good, what does the multitude do? Well, you know, we could have been at a better place. What's going on? There's no snacks here. I thought they would serve some drinks. What's happening? And they started claiming things, and Jesus sees the need. Now Philip comes unto Jesus and says, hey, master, you should send them out. Go send them out so they can get something to eat. I mean, the day is coming over, you know. It's been a long day. Nothing about 8 hours and a couple of breaks. It's been 14 hours long, 15 hours long, 18 hours long. They need to eat. Can you send them off? What did Jesus say? You feed them. You deal with that. See, Jesus is going to bring people to church. And now we're talking. And you're going to say, why are we getting this type of people at church, man? We should be getting this quality, but we're getting this quality. And I know that doesn't happen at this church. It happens in other churches. But that's the reality, that if you and I are here, that's the quality we're getting, man. That's the reality. If you and I are here, this is exactly what we need to deal with. Now the disciples are like, hey, Jesus, wait a minute. We didn't sign up for this. We signed up to be next to you, to listen to the speech, to look at the miracles. But what do you mean giving them food? How do you pretend for us to feed them? Not even 200 denarii would be enough to care for all these people. And there is no bakery in town that would have enough bread for all these people. Some scholars said, I mean, we talk about the 5,000 being fed. Some scholars said that it was between 15 to 20,000 people that day being fed by Jesus. In all this story makes sense for one individual. And that's where I want to focus this morning. And I have a few minutes to do that. One individual. There's this small kid. I would think that he was a pathfinder. He was probably an adventure moving into pathfinders. And just think about it, please. Imagine with me, that day he comes to his mom and says, Mom, guess what? Jesus is coming to town. All my friends are going. Can I go, Mom? Oh, man. Jesus would move adults younger people, and even children. This is amazing. When you present Jesus, even the children come. And if children are there, the program must be good. Because if they are there, man, that must be good. Whatever has been offered, somebody's caring for them, and they know it. You know, kids understand when we care for them. You don't have to speak their language, but they can feel it. They can sense it. They can see it. Am I being welcome at this place, or am I not welcome? Kids can say that. Kids can know that. Now, can you imagine this group of kids, and especially this individual who comes to his mom and says, "Mom, I want to go. I mean, all my friends are going. Can I go see Jesus?" What did that mama say? Oh, man. Now I want to talk to the families. That mom said, "Yes, you may. Yes, you go and see Jesus." But listen. Not only did the mom, and let's not forget about the dad, not only did the parents say, "You can go see Jesus," but wait a minute. "I'm going to fix you a lunch so you can go." This was not just any mama. She would prepare the meal so the son can go out and see Jesus. Why is this crucial in today's time? Oh, because we have a new generation of parents. And parents, I'm going to talk to you because that's part of my responsibility being here. "Can I go to church?" "Oh, no. We can stay home. Let's watch it on Zoom." "Can I go to club?" "Oh, no, it's too boring, too tiring, too much time, too much work. Why do you have to do another program for them? Can they just stay home?" See, parents, it is our duty and our responsibility to let him go to Jesus. Jesus even said to himself, "Let him come unto me." Do not hinder the children to come close to Jesus. This is the place where they can get trained, they can get nurtured, they can get discipled. We need to send them closer and not away from Jesus. I could see this mom, I could see this dad getting up that morning and saying, "Yes, you're going, but you're not just going on your own. I'm going to make sure you have some lunch for the road." This is intentional. This is not a parent that neglects their family and their children and says, "Well, you know what? It's not my business. I do not care about it. It's about the pastor or the children or the leaders. They will provide for it." No. Parents that take responsibility to provide for their children. I know it's not easy. But I could just picture that mom, that dad getting up that day saying, "You will go see Jesus. And not only you're going, but you're taking something with you." I want to think about the character of that boy. Because now Jesus is dealing with Philip. Jesus is dealing with the adults here, or the younger generation here. And he's telling them, "You will feed them." And he's like, "Well, what do you mean? I mean, we have no food. There's no baker in town." He goes to Andrew and they talk to each other and they're like, "Well, the math doesn't work. We don't have enough savings." Talk to Judas. He doesn't have any bank account to cover that. "There is no way we can pay for that, and there is no way we can order that. Uber Eats will not work today. There is no way they can bring all that food right now to this area. We are in a deserted place, and who's going to bring it? 20,000 people. Who's going to feed them?" They're dealing with that. But Jesus knows about this young boy. He understands the heart of this boy. Now they go out. And please, work with me here. 20,000 people. Think about this. A culture that understands that they're going to be out all day. When you know you're going to a big event and you understand you're going to be traveling for hours, tell me, do you go without a lunch? You seriously planning to go without lunch? 20,000 people approx, and the disciples go out and start asking, "Do you have something to share? Did you bring anything for potluck? Do you have something to share with somebody else?" I could almost hear those answers. "I'm sorry, I only pack enough for us. I'm sorry, next Sabbath when you tell me with more time, I might be able to do something. Right now, it doesn't work like that, Jesus. The agenda does not cover it. There must be a memo a month ahead so we can do something, and we'll see." We become very complicated. Have you noticed that? Like we become to the point that it's just like, oh, unless they tell me we're 3 months ahead, there's no way because it doesn't cover my budget. See, I'm sure he was asking, I'm sure the disciples were around the multitude asking, who has something to share? Do you have something you could give to somebody else? Can you picture that little boy raising his hand? Hey, over here. Hey, over here. Stay away, you know, we understand, you don't have enough. Move. Hey, over here, I have something that I can give to Jesus. This is why the gospel was given to the children. Because when time comes to serve, there's no agenda, there's no other priority. They drop everything. I'm telling you, I've seen it myself. They're willing to put everything aside just to say, can I go and serve with you, Jesus? Think about this boy. Verse 9. Listen to the words the disciples describe him with. Verse 9, it says, chapter 6 of John, verse 9, there is a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes. But what's this for so many? Even the speech or the language that has been used is somehow not necessarily uplifting. Let's put it that way. It's kind of saying, you know, there's like a couple of snacks here, but basically nothing. And can you see Jesus about to show his disciples one of the greatest miracles performed by the service of a young lad who was willing to say, Jesus, I don't have much, but the little that I have, I'm bringing it to you. And Jesus sees those small baby steps we take of faith when we say we don't have much, but the little we have, we're willing to put it in your hands. And now can you see Jesus multiplying it by 20,000 and even leftovers? See, this is the powerful, this is the miracle of the gospel. This is the work of the gospel. In between all these great miracles that Jesus is performing throughout the day, he's about to close that day with one of the greatest lessons the church was to learn, even in today's time. Do not neglect the youth thinking that they're too young, too small to serve, thinking that somehow they can't make a difference. I'm telling you, man, God can move mountains if it's necessary for one of these young lads who's willing to say, I'm here, can you use me? This is wonderful. When the parents, when the church, when the school, when we all work together, we are able to raise a generation with a clear mindset of their purpose in life and of the calling they have. This job was not done just by a couple of people. There was a whole community behind this young fellow who was able to say, here I am to serve. Why was he ready to serve? I'm pretty sure he had grandparents, he had parents who constantly helped him to understand his role in society. He didn't come on that to his own. He didn't do it on his own. There was a whole church community who was helping him to see that when the time came that the master would call him, he would be ready to say, I am here. I want to serve. There is a role you and I play within the church movement to raise a whole generation. You might say, well, Pastor, you're talking to me and I'm not even married. I'm single. They're not my children. They're somebody else's children. They're not my worry. No. There's no such a thing of that mindset within the church. The children of one is the children of all. The success of one is the success of all of us as a community. When we see our young people thriving, we see a whole community thriving. We cannot work as small islands thinking, well, it's their responsibility. Look at that pastor. See how they're doing. No. There's no such a time. There's no time to point fingers. There's only time to say, how can I help with your load? Can I give you a hand? Is there something I can do to give you a break? Maybe I can look after them. Maybe I can come and support you. the youth will take their stand when we all take our stand. Somehow we expect that the youth will come and change the church. The youth will only change when the church is ready to help him to get to that point. I could only see the disciples' faces that day, looking at Jesus and looking at the 5 barley loaves and the 2 fishes and saying, "Well, Master, why you even bother? This is not even enough. I mean, not even enough for us, for one person. Why do you bother?" And patiently Jesus taking the food, the basket of food, and praying over it, asking the Father to give wisdom to his disciples to understand, it is not with might and it is not with an army, it is with his power that we will see miracles taking place. When we see the challenges that we have around our conference and around Chilliwack itself, we know that we are just very minimum. We're small. We hardly exist. But when we understand the power of God and what he can do with 1 or 2 that are committed to him, he can change the whole outcome. I'm praying for 10. That's my prayer. I said, "Lord, give me 10 leaders. Out of the 200 that I have there, give me 10 that understand the power where you, that understand the vision where you want to take them. With 10, I know we can change the whole BC conference." And I'm not just talking about BC conference now, I'm talking about whole Canada. Let me tell you, brothers, and this is the burden I carry. Unless we change the vision of the church, we won't survive another 10 years. This is drastic, but this is the reality. Unless we change the vision of the church and the way we're doing things with the youth, we won't make it 10 years. Why do I say that? Because I see them getting lost every year. In fact, last night I talked to them and I said, "Are your friends here?" They said, "No, I want you to pray for my friend, for my brother, for my sister." They're here, but they're also seeing that they're getting their numbers dropped because they're not connecting. There is something that needs to happen within the BC conference and all over Canada. Otherwise, our church is dying. This is the reality. You have a great church here, and we almost have a full building here. But if you move to other regions, you're going to see churches of 10, 15 people. So what are you trying to say, Pastor? Well, what I'm trying to say is I need you to pray. I need you to pray for our youth. And I need you to support them. They're planning to go to Gillette. They're planning to go to Mountain View. They're planning to do activities. They're planning to do a youth Sabbath. Be there. Support them. Give them what they need. Give them the opportunity. You won't regret it. You won't regret it. Because their success is our success. God is coming very soon. Jesus is returning very, very quickly. He's calling a generation of youth that can take the stand for his truth. This is the time. Fearless in service. It's not about a slogan, or it's not about just trying to look cool. It's about putting the boots on. It's about getting the gear on to go to work. I challenged the youth last night and I said, "You have received a blessing tonight with communion service. You can't take that blessing unto yourself and keep it. You now have to take it somewhere else." And I said, "Who's willing to go out to Chilliwack and share that with people out there? You should see their faces." Because I know one thing, and I finish with this. If I can teach a young person to win a soul for Christ, and they go through the experience of seeing how somebody gets transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit, they will never leave the church. Once they taste the power of God and how he can change the life of somebody else, they are now disciples of Christ. Meanwhile, they're only followers. Listen to that. Meanwhile, we're only followers. It's until we get ourselves a little bit dirty and we go into the H, you know, to that part of town where nobody likes to go, but we go there and we start serving and winning souls for Christ, that we become disciples of Christ. I want them to be disciples. Would you help me pray for them? Would you help me pray for you and me so we can fulfill the calling God has given us? Oh, brother and sister, time is short. This is the time God is calling us to work together, to partner together. If we keep looking at each other, we will see many flaws. We have to start looking out to the needs out there. We can't continue to look into each other. We waste too much time on that. I have no time to waste on that. We're moving forward. The train is starting to move, and the youth will create this movement. I want you to pray for them, and I want you to encourage them. And I want to pray for you. That when the time comes and the master says, who has food to feed them? You will say, Lord, I don't have much. I hardly know a little bit of the Bible, and I hardly know a little bit of this and that, but this is the little things I have. Can I offer them to you? And I can tell you, God will multiply that. It's not about the amount. It's about the quality. It's about the intention, the willingness. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we come to you with humble hearts, challenged by the story of this young lad who we don't even know the name of him, but he was so special that is written in the Gospels as a fearless servant of yours who was willing to raise his hand and said, here, I have a small box of lunch. Use it. And you were able to multiply, Lord, by thousands. Thank you, Jesus, for showing us that in the kingdom of God, things do not work according to our agenda. They work according to yours. We ask you, Lord, to please give us the faith to know that we're not doing this on our own, that you are the one who's leading. We pray for our youth here in Chilliwack. We pray for the children. We pray for the Pathfinders, for the children's ministry, for the older folks too. We pray for everybody, Lord, that we will work together in unity, fulfilling the mission you've calling us to do, Lord. I pray for the youth that are out there in the gym today. They're probably having lunch now. I pray that you will touch them by the power of your Holy Spirit, and they will be compelled to go and share with somebody else the blessings they've been receiving over the past few days. Thank you for letting us work together with the Chilliwack Church. We pray for this community now, and as we go out onto the streets, we pray that you will take us to the places where you need us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Message. Let's complete the message with the to be a watchman, blow the gospel trumpet, because every soul warning. Give 368. And whosoever no 368. I thought 367. Okay. And whosoever hear the message may repent and turning. Let's rescue the perishing. 367. Please stand.
You got back.
Let's pray. Lord, thank you for reminding us that the mission and the purpose you have us here for it is to reach out to others. Give us the ability, the connection, the words to care for those who are in need. We pray for our families, for the parents of this church, for the children. We lift them up, Lord, so they will be ready when the time calls. They will raise their hand and say, Lord, here I am, use me. We pray for the leadership of the church. Thank you for their hospitality they've shown us so far, and thank you for the partnership we've worked with them. Our efforts are small, Lord, but we now put them in your hands. May you bless it and multiply it so many hundreds and thousands can be blessed by it here in Chilliwack. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.